decent.
No, people buying houses for me for the school system here. I hear it all the time.
I think they're getting some, I mean, Bridget's in a, like, 120.
Tonight's meeting is being recorded on RCTV, and you can see it on Comcast Channel 22 or Verizon Channel 33. Check www.rctv.org for more information and for replay times. 7 o'clock, we have a continued notice of intent hearing for 270-0676, Low Meadow, Map 14, Lot 15, Haskell, and the public hearing is now being reopened and being conducted concurrently under the authority of the Mass Wetlands Protection Act, Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 31, Section 40, as amended, and the Reading General Bylaws, Section 7.1. Hearing will be conducted in the following manner. The applicant presents the proposal. Commission will receive reports, technical advisors, and other town departments, and the commission will address questions and comments to the applicant, and the public will then be given the opportunity to ask questions of the applicant, which should be directed to the chair. I'm the chair. And then when you do that, please give your name and address before your comments and or questions are presented. At this time, I'd like to introduce the members of the Conservation Commission, starting on my right.
David Pinnett.
Al Couillard.
Harry Curtis.
Rebecca Longley, chair.
Nika Scanlon, Vice Chair.
Chuck Tironi, Conservation Administrator. I don't have it.
Seven of you.
And I have a half.
Okay.
Chuck. This is Low Meadow.
I don't see anyone here at Low Meadow right now.
Putting it in these people's backyards.
Were we expecting
like there's quite a few
them?
Yeah, he contacted me this morning and talked about the, you know, what to expect for tonight's meeting.
All right.
So I guess we could just wait.
Just table it till the
Madam Chair, I propose we move it to the bottom of our hearings.
Let's continue then with Simon's Way, Reading Rifle and Revolver Club. This is Notice of Intent 270-0678, and I could go through that whole spiel, but I'm not going to because I just said it.
Well, hello, let me introduce myself. I'm John Maruso. I'm the Vice President of Reading Rifle and Revolver Club. My colleague, Mark Slager, engineer that's been on this project, was called away tonight. He can't be here. But we have answered all of the questions that this commission has given to us at the last meeting. We have our replies electronically. I can read them here, which was our version of the electronic letter. We also have some visual aids here if you need to, and I also have the information on thumb drive. So if you care to put up some of the information, which could be possibly projected.
Yeah, it's oh, you want to put out that one? Sure thing. Hold on one second.
Plans are been colorized. They have been colorized. These are the answers to the questions that were put to us at the last meeting. which was stockpiled. Locations of the sand fill have been added to the plan. Here, and they would all be within the confines of the range. Detailed construction sequence is here. Sequence, and this is the second remote control notice. This is
I assume it's in his notes. Yeah.
The second page.
This is the information on the planting of the trees. This is the landscaping planting regimen schedule. Takes care of that. Constructive detail for deflector post and firing line roof are enclosed. And that's on the electronic one here. And I also have it in my thumb drive. But that's been submitted. You probably have that detail? Okay, it shows it's basically a porch. Roof, as I call it, might be here in particular. It shows a side view of
the
construction.
Fire line roof?
Say again?
That's the fire line roof?
Yes, yes.
Can I ask a question?
Yeah, sure.
On the deflector post detail?
Yes.
The footing for that is 1'6". I'm just asking, do you think that's sufficiently deep enough for frost heave concerns, or is there?
Did you put that up? That was done by an engineer, a PE.
Okay.
And whose expertise is civil.
I just asked the question. I thought there was a fixed depth, like.
Generally, it's 4 feet.
Generally, it's 4 feet.
Right.
To be a frost footing.
But I don't know if the depth to groundwater is extremely shallow.
Concrete displaces the water anyway when you pour the footing.
That was my main comment on that detail.
All that,
we asked about that last week too.
Yeah.
We asked,
we did. Yeah. 1'6" depth.
So, is that sufficient?
Is that the diameter or the depth?
Well, they're 2 feet. 24-inch square concrete footing, and they would be poured in place because they will have lags to bolt the post to. So a big foot probably wouldn't be good enough. So therefore, why the poured concrete? So the lags would be coming out to attach the post to. And the height is, say again? Oh yeah, there it is. And the height is 1'6". I left that up to the engineer.
So is that a separate footing or a continuous footing?
Separate. Each one would be separate. But again, that's a construction detail.
That would be for Glenn to approve anyway.
That's right. That's building.
Yeah.
And here is a schematic, which I have on my own hand copy, of a schematic of the firing line roof, deflected detail, ready right here. So if you can see that, that might be another slide of. For all to see.
This is another fire line?
Yeah, I think I have. Yeah, there you go. I have more than necessary. So that's what that was. That was one of the questions. And I did talk with Glenn, and that's a probable. And the other one, more than likely, I'll need a permit for that, building permit, when the time comes. But as far as the permit for the deflectors, it's to be determined.
Okay.
Yes.
Just another question. Just as a comment, I like the planting plan.
Yes.
I like the number and the spacing and the location of the plantings.
Yes.
Where are the trees that are getting cut? Where are they getting cut? What area are they getting cut from?
Oh.
Just.
In here.
That entire range area.
I wish I could hit the right button. Excuse me, they're being cut within this confine.
Oh, gotcha, the tree line.
We marked the ones that we were told to mark.
Gotcha.
So that takes care of that. And we're planting excess, more or less.
And I like to see the variety of trees and shrubs.
Yes, and we went through the schedule.
Yeah.
And then, different ones. I can read the plants we're planting.
I trust their native species.
Them are native.
Yeah.
They're a mix of both.
They're off of Redding's list.
That's sufficient.
Manufacturer's cut sheet for the concrete retaining wall are enclosed. Specifications for removal of the HESCO barriers are enclosed. And based on conversation we had with the building commissioner, the roof over the firing line will require a building permit. The commissioner could not determine if the permit would be required for the reflected shields. It would make determination after additional construction details provided, which is normal for granting building conditions inside of a buffer zone. Bottom line, this is the plot you've been working. The finished details of a house and so forth are determined later by a building department, but this will be in the firing line. A few other documents here I may want to show. HESCO barrier detail. I think I have them here to pass out. And if I may, which is worth 1,000 words, these contain additional photo pictures. I think you have enough. Shows the lock blocks, which are in the back of the wall. It shows the HESCO blocks themselves as assembled and also as disassembled. Many times they want to abandon a fire base out in the desert, hostile area, so they do not want to leave a fortress behind. So it gives explicit pictures of how they're filled, how they're used, and how they are also disassembled. These other pictures here are of a friendly, another colleague. This is from another firing range in Massachusetts. And this is an example of what a deflector would look like. Not per se we would build that exactly, but the materials added there are pretty close, because these have a rubberized face and there's steel behind them. So they're professionally designed for that purpose. To absorb splatter. And that gives an idea of what the front would be. Here's, that would be the roof line.
Mm-hmm.
And so forth. So as usual, the picture answers a lot of questions. Yeah.
Chuck, did you look at the range inspection and maintenance?
I did.
And the maintenance is also on the plan. Barriers are to be inspected monthly by the range officer. Damage that allows fill to spill out of the barrier will be repaired in place in accordance with the manufacturer's specifications. If the HESCO barrier cannot be repaired in place, remove and replace the affected section in accordance with the procedure provided. By the way, we have 2 work days a year, and that's general spring and fall cleaning. And at that time, that's when majority of the major maintenance would be done in that area. And it's only in this area, these areas here, targets there and so forth. They go out and rebuild them, they repair them, they groom the grounds. So the target stands ought to be repaired as needed each spring and fall, or as otherwise needed to ensure their proper functioning. Brush is to be mowed each spring and fall after each growing season. This is the detail here for the HESCO barrier removal and replacement. Construction sequence of erosion control. We've added erosion control around the edges here on the build. Also, we would follow scrupulous detail. We better drink water first. We would follow scrupulous detail when we're filling these.
Do other members of the commission have any questions?
Nope. I don't.
Chuck, do you have any questions?
I do not.
When filling, we would have men on the back side We would put plastic top down, and they would hand brush it and sweep it. I believe that's in the initial request that that has gone through discussions with this committee and also much discussion with Ron.
I appreciate your information. I thought it was very, gives you a very good idea of what you are proposing.
Thank you. Thank you.
Are there any questions from the community? Okay, hearing none.
I move we close the public hearing for notice of intent
for the Reading Rifle Range.
Thank you. 270-0678. Do I hear a second?
Yeah,
a second.
All those in favor?
Just catches his corner.
And it's abstained.
And those abstained. Dave is abstained.
Abstained.
Okay.
I take it the project is approved?
Yes. It is, and you will get, we will look at an order of conditions next meeting, which will be the 22nd of February.
Okay.
And after that's
when,
the,
can you wait
will you have that? Thank
you.
Harry.
Being 717, we can continue with Low Meadow, map 14, lot 15, Haskell.
Stephen Erickson, North Environmental Services. Commissioners have all seen this. At the last hearing, we asked that all the trees on site 6 inches or over be located. We have located those on the plan. They asked for the total number of trees to be removed, and that would be 40. They asked for a test hole location and soil profile for the infiltration trench, and we provided that with 8.5 feet in sand and gravel and no water. You asked for a construction detail of the infiltration unit, which has been provided. You substituted some arborvitae and red maple for what was blueberry and winterberry plantings that probably wouldn't do well there because it's sand and gravel and it's very droughty. You added a post and rail fence along the limit of work to the north. You asked for the height of the commission and that will be building, and that would be no more than 35 feet in height. And the commission asked for the area of the house. That would be 2,900 square feet. So I think we provided everything that the commission asked for. We meet all the performance standards of the Wetland Protection Act and to the maximum extent feasible of the local wetland bylaw.
Questions from the commission.
I think Mr. Erickson answered our questions. For me, anyway.
Steve, when did you provide the wildlife habitat the last time, or did we get it this?
We did do a wildlife habitat study, and you have that.
Yes, I looked at that today. I thought it could have, and it was appendix. It was Appendix B, which is the more detailed form.
The problem with the wildlife habitat study forms is that they concentrate on the wetland area where the work is being done. So if you read the question, it says, what is the impact in the area being worked on in the resource area? Well,
that isn't really relevant to this, because even though we're in the resource area, we're in an upland area, and they're specifically asking about wetland resource areas.
No, no, I understand that, but then there are items in that form. I was looking at that, and I was also looking at the manual, and it also does get into a little bit of the continuity of, in this case, it's the riverfront area, and the continuity of the riverfront area to that larger piece that the applicant owns, which is that huge area.
Yes.
I think on the face of it, it's fine. I might have looked for a little bit more description on, you know, things that would be in the wetland. And what I haven't seen is any kind of mitigation. And I understand, if I read the regs correctly, that this property was deemed a developable lot a ways back, and that, you know, you don't necessarily have to provide everything for the wildlife habitat. But you need to maybe do something as best you can. And I'm kind of stumbling over my words. And I was wondering if there, because of this area in the wetland, and it is very large, I think you had it as 25 acres or 10?
It's a very large.
Yeah, and
yes.
I think it's probably very important. And I was wondering if there might be some things that you might, your applicant might offer as improvement or enhancement.
We have more than open suggestions. If you wanted something like wood duck boxes,
that's where I was going.
It'd be a perfect spot for it.
That's what I was thinking. So, would other members of the commission be amenable to that type of a thing?
I would say yes.
Yeah. Chuck?
You can specify a number, 5 or 10, and we'll see to it that he puts them out there. It really is a perfect spot for wood ducks if they have a nesting area.
Yeah. And I guess you saw some red-tailed hawks. And
yep.
Out there. So we know it's pretty valuable, at least for raptors and migrating waterfowl.
How many acres are we talking about, Steve?
The wetlands in the back, all told, is over 25 acres combined with this property here. So it's a good sized marsh out there.
The 10 would be like almost every 2 acres.
Well, they only have 4.6 acres in this parcel.
I know, but you're gonna put them all back, aren't you?
Well, we have to put them on our property.
Yeah,
can't
the 14,
yeah.
Is it 14?
We put them on somebody else's
property.
4.6. Oh, I thought he owned the whole parcel.
Yeah.
So the part, your parcel is only 14?
Four.
Yes.
Four.
Four.
Four. Four acres, yes.
So 10 would be
a lot.
Yeah. I don't know. What do you think? Give him a number.
Five.
I'd say four. Probably four nesting boxes.
I want 4.5 then.
That's fine.
I'll go with five.
Yeah. You have
especially
to look.
We, you know,
just
if we could get permission to put it on someone else's land, I wouldn't have a problem adding a few more. It's just that
the only reason why I said four is there's not, it might be 4.6 acres, but the majority of it is not treed.
Yeah.
To mount the boxes on. So.
Don't you put them on stands? I've seen them on stands.
Yeah.
Yeah, posts.
I'm sorry?
I've seen them on posts.
Yeah.
You could.
No, the idea is to put them on something like an iron pipe.
Yep.
Because you want something, you know, if you put a regular post, something like a raccoon can climb up
right.
And eat the eggs. And an iron pipe, they just can't get up on. So typically you put an iron pipe in there, banging it to the ground so it's solid. And it's got a flange on the top. You put the flange on and you attach the box to that.
Great.
It should be good for at least several years.
Mm-hmm.
Sounds like five it is.
No. Of course, you know, there are restrictions on the size of the opening and all that, but they're common. You can buy them all over the place.
Okay.
That's yours.
Yeah.
Okay. Any other comments from the commission?
on the entire proposal or just on the habitat study?
The entire proposal.
So I guess I still don't feel like I see much of the way of mitigation. I understand that it's the performance standards. And you know, the two things at the end of this process that I think I'm most concerned about are runoff into the river, so something to prevent fertilizer, herbicide, pesticide running off into the river and the wetland. Has anything been done to prevent that?
First off, we're infiltrating all of the rooftop. Second off, we've minimized the lawn area. And the only reason it's as large as it is because we need room to put an infiltration chamber in there. So between that, we've got minimal lawn area, we've got minimal area that will be fertilized, plus it's a sandy gravel soil.
So the answer is no?
The answer is that we're not going to have much runoff there to begin with.
Okay, so there's nothing to prevent any runoff.
And if there's anything else we can do, if the commission wants to put a condition on that, then no fertilizers, no low nitrogen, low phosphorus fertilizers.
Okay.
And I don't have a problem with that.
Okay.
The hard part is enforcing it, obviously.
Well, if you don't have it in there, you can't enforce it at all. So, the other thing is you know, I've been trying to figure out what's reasonable additional mitigation. And it dawned on me when I was out there Sunday with the Trails Committee, there is so much trash out there that has been dumped. There are pallets, there are plastic buckets, there's an iron barrel behind one of the houses on Arnold Avenue. So,
can you be more specific where those?
Where you saw that trash? Did you see it behind this property, or did you see it along that?
It's
river.
It's, I believe it's in the confines of this lot. So,
oh, down near the cul-de-sac. More near the cul-de-sac?
And I don't know, I couldn't tell where the property line was, so I don't know what is dumping from the neighbors. There's clearly an awful lot of leaves being dumped back there, which is also a problem. So I guess what I would say, in order to get comfortable with this, one of the things I like to do, I'd like to see, is to see all the trash removed.
I don't have a problem with that. It, you know, to sell the property, you want to have a clean piece of property to begin with. And I think you're right, the end of that cul-de-sac ends up being a collection area. People apparently stop there and throw things out their window.
And there are a whole bunch of, I don't know where they come from, but behind some of the houses there are tons of beer cans that look very, very recent. So someone's up that beer can. But, you know, there's like a milk crate in the middle of the marsh. I think I didn't catalog it, but I think that would make a big difference to cleaning it up.
I don't see any reason why you couldn't put that condition on the property, but it's to the builder's credit that,
yeah,
the cleaner it is, the more likely he's to be able to sell it.
Yeah.
So none of that stuff is a good thing to have on the property, and I agree with you. I don't think there's anything wrong with conditioning that.
Are you agreeing to both trash and yard waste?
Yeah. That's specifically on that particular site. Obviously, we can't take it off somebody else's site.
Sure.
Right.
We should probably stipulate that that's done by hand.
It's the only way to do it, and then it's all over. Yeah, it's too wet to. It's in between the two channels of the river.
I thought there was some grass clippings back here.
It's grass clippings, it's leaves.
But that was on the apple area. You could do that one.
No. I'll give you some of the highlights. So there's a ton of leaves dumped here. There's beer cans. The iron barrel is somewhere down here. There's the occasional soccer ball, plastic buckets. There's a milk crate here. There are at least two pallets. There are big boards in the river or near the river where I think people used it to bridge across. So that's what I saw. So I would say just get all that going
on. Well, that could be taken out by hand as long as it's nothing that requires a machine.
There's nothing
to
too heavy to lift.
Okay.
Yeah.
Any questions from the community? Mr. Rauchy?
Yep, Dave Rauchy. Thank you. Well, to stay on point with your trees that you're going to take down,
yes,
40 or so, and you knocked out at least 15 earlier with the soil sample.
Yes.
Are we going to talk about the soil sample also? Because that was part of the condition from the last meeting also. You guys were going to talk about the soil sample. We were talking about the stability of the land.
We received a stormwater report, which was why they did the infiltration trench, and they showed that their infiltration, they understood what kind of soil it was, and they designed their system to meet what they found.
So it's mostly sand? There was a lot of sand?
A lot of sand.
It's all sand and gravel. It's a small esket-like formation. Not a true esket because it's not big enough.
All right, let me go back to the trees. So 40 trees that are down, plus the 50 that are down. I'm not sure if that's counted or not. But how are you going to replace these 40 trees that are on the property?
We will make a donation to the, under the tree policy. We can't put 40 new trees on the property and expect them to grow. You can't take a tree and plop it down in the middle of a wood area because it's just not going to grow.
I've been probably about, would you say I've probably been 10 to 12 meetings this year here, and listened to a lot of people that are putting on decks, driveways, et cetera, and everyone has been issued to the trees, somewhat trees or some type of shrubs that are there to replace them.
There are some trees that have been proposed, is arborvitae?
We have some trees and shrubs on the back of the property that we're proposing. But I don't know what everybody else is proposing, but I also
property?
Don't know if they're bought.
And
it's a kind of area where it's all wooded, except for a small area of the front. If I put a tree there, it's got a 90% chance it's going to die. You don't want that density.
Plus it's
Steve, did you put arborvitaes along the northern edge of the property?
Yes, we did.
Okay.
Part of that is to have a visual barrier
right
from the wetland
and
any migratory pathway that might be there.
Five.
Yep, and then there's
five
some
along
more
the
along the property line on the front of Arcadia. And then there appears to be some, are those shrubs in the back?
We've got some on the front, we've got some in the back, and we've got some on the side. The side and the back are the visual barriers that we're hoping for. The front is more decorative, landscaping kind of thing,
mm-hmm,
than anything else.
So I brought up the last meeting about the footage of the house, as far as the foundation, how is it going to be held and so forth, and they were like, the soil is sufficient. Now you're saying it's sand and gravel, right? As far as I know about sand, it's not a very, very strong solid wood to hold a foundation.
Sand and gravel is the best
gravel,
base
yes,
that you can put
I
on.
I didn't see any gravel when I went up there. I live next door.
Yep.
Okay,
that's,
so I jumped over there.
That's not excellent.
I saw at least they went in, I'd say approximately 6 to 8 feet. It was all sand.
They were down 8.5 feet. But the sand, all the sand and gravel, is an excellent base. In fact, they call for it.
Do you have a sample?
Filling areas,
do you
because
sample?
You get 90% compaction
and
no time at all.
Do you have a sample of that?
No, I don't.
Who has the sample?
Sample was done by, who did the borings?
Sullivan.
Jack Sullivan, a professional engineer.
Right, so those, there are soil boring logs.
Is it public?
It's all in the information that the conservation has.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The significance, the value of that test pit information is for conservation to get a sense as to whether or not that infiltration basin that they're installing is really going to function.
I'm going there next. I don't think.
Well, that's
right.
but that's the supporting data to that's their evidence that supports the sizing of that infiltration basin,
mm-hmm,
and the construction, the design of that infiltration basin.
Did you happen to look at that?
I did. Yes,
you
did? I did.
And you're much more knowledgeable than I am.
Well, I've seen a couple of these designs. That's true. I'm not professionally an engineer.
But a
professional
engineer
did
do the analysis.
Right.
And
did
he's
do
done
this
quite
design.
A bit of work in the town.
And typically when he does, I can't give a critique of this particular design, but typically when he does put forth designs, one of his common practice, since he knows we do check it, is he typically slightly oversizes the infiltration basin.
It doesn't seem
that's
like
my,
it. I go back
that's
to
my
his,
experience
you
with
know,
him.
Perfect, you know, the runoff. It looks like there's going to be runoff. It's a very, you know, steep parcel of land. It's going to run off to the river. It's going to run into our land. It's going to run off to my neighbor's land.
Yeah.
I don't think the filter system is...
Okay, so the
yes.
runoff
yeah.
is going, if I can just give it a
sure.
step. The runoff is going to happen on, if you can imagine, you know, taking a bird's eye view over this property. The runoff is going to occur when it hits a solid surface that the rain can't infiltrate through.
Well, we're going to knock
down
the 40 trees.
True. And you'll replace that with a roof and some pavement and some sidewalk and other surface area that does not act like soil, you know, that does that. So that rain drop has to go somewhere once it hits that roof. Okay, so what they are doing is they have designed to collect all the rainwater that falls on all the roof, which is all the impervious on this lot except for the driveway and the walkway. Okay, so it's well over half of the impervious area, surface area. And they're proposing to take all that water that's collected through those gutters and infiltrate it into a backyard underground infiltration chamber. Okay? So that's their proposal.
And the size again of it? I'm sorry.
1,000 gallons.
1,000.
Jack, you have a profile of it?
Yep, it's 1,000 gallon dry well.
Okay.
Is it on that sheet?
It's at the bottom of.
Yeah, I get that.
Your best estimate coming rainwater, say XYZ amount of inches on.
So what they did in this drainage design,
mm-hmm.
is they throughout this are a variety of charts that anticipate the peak volume of runoff, cubic feet per second. Based on different types of storms, like a 3.5-inch storm, a 5-inch storm, and we're talking about within 24 hours. Okay, so up to 7 inches within 24 hours.
Okay.
And that's it's in the ballpark of what Reading experiences.
And what's going to happen to the driveway? If say snow, where are they gonna remove the snow?
So that will depend on the slope of the driveway at the time. So if you see part of the driveway is sloped toward Arcadia Avenue. Okay, so part of that driveway is going, all that rainwater is gonna flow towards the street and ideally towards a storm drain that captures it so it doesn't create a road hazard.
Storm drains down near Arnold.
So I don't know where the nearest storm drain is. Sewer main. I mean, I see sewer main there.
Is there ability to put a storm drain in?
Your name, please?
Sorry, Greg Salvatelli, 25 Arnold. Is there ability to put a storm drain in to mitigate that driveway runoff? Because the nearest storm drains are around the bend or towards another corner. I don't see necessarily that water is going to make it all the way down there.
I think that's the closest storm drain.
I think that's, yeah. It's not shown on the plan, Mr.
What's this?
Do you know?
Storm drains up.
SPD.
Is that in the report? Is that in the drainage report?
I couldn't tell you offhand, but it's typically not something we worry about a heck of a lot. It doesn't have much to do with conservation. And I'm sure that every house on the street has more runoff going into the street than our house will.
Yeah, the,
we're infiltrating.
So all the driveway stuff is, you know, we can talk about what happens on the site, but the driveway cut and what happens when it goes into the road is an engineering question. And they actually have to give a permit to allow that cut to go in there. So those questions could be directed to engineering. There's not a hearing for that, and you should go and talk to them.
Well, Chuck,
it's a good question.
If you have snow, right, where is it gonna end up? That's a question for conservation, because eventually it's gonna end up in the river.
Well, and then that's exactly where we would want it to go as soon as the
if I look at the driveway correctly, if the plow comes in and he plows it, it's gonna go this way, correct? If they have a snow blower, where is it gonna go? They're gonna blow it some way, either in my neighbor's yard or in the back. Now that's a conservation question.
It would be a conservation question for this material, but snow on the driveway is not gonna change the outcome of this project.
Plus, you know, there are things, I mean, we're not allowed to blow the snow in the street and you know, block drainage and stuff like that. It's gotta be on our property. I mean, I shovel my driveway and my sidewalk, and I make sure it's not out on some ramp.
Yeah,
so
on subdivisions, they ask to show a snow storage area, but not on single family houses. So if he pushed it off the back of the driveway and maybe some on the side, that won't go anywhere. That'll just seep into the ground, and there might be some sediment from what was on the driveway, some gravel that needs to be cleaned up in the spring, but it really wouldn't create an erosion issue that would run all the way down the street.
Sweeping.
Yeah.
And okay.
Well, there's more.
Yes, please.
It's Eric Fournier, 30 Arnold Avenue. Last meeting, we were discussing whether or not the frontage was appropriate, and there was a question about whether or not the line to the, I guess, the west, which is right on the Woburn side of that, was it actually an appropriate line? And so we weren't sure because of the way the plan was in the cul-de-sac on Arnold Ave, there was a proposal for an easement with two parking spaces to prove that they had the frontage, yet it wasn't we weren't sure if that was actually the right, if the land, the mapping was correct. And so I wanted to make sure that we actually still have the frontage appropriate for this project to move forward or not.
I asked someone from the ZBA, and they told me that the lot is legal to build on, because they have the frontage is actually in the cul-de-sac on Arnold Ave. That's where the total frontage that's required for the house to be built, and that's where it is. So the lot, according to the person that I talked to, said that yes, it is a legal lot to build on. It does have the correct frontage.
And was that the previous ZBA?
Pardon?
Or when in town meeting we passed the new
this
law.
This was the new.
That's based upon the new
a month and a half ago.
So it's grandfathered in from?
Yes.
All right, so let me just add some new information. So that came up in town hall this week, and we asked Jack Sullivan to look into that. So that's a situation that has nothing to do with conservation, because we don't look at frontage, and we just kind of, if this house goes in that spot, will it harm the wetlands? That's really where we're looking. But that came up, and it's going to be solved. It's a good question. Our GIS coordinator spotted it and brought it to the attention of the planning and engineering department. And then it was sent to Jack, and it was sent to Steve too. And they're, according to what I've heard, is that Jack got his plan from the original road layout And there's another plan. I think it's a road layout that is the one that takes precedent over where this line is. But Woburn is being asked also. So I'm not really involved, but I know that it's being looked at. So it's a good question, and it's going to be solved.
The only comment I would make, obviously I recognize that there's a letter of the law and we're meeting some of the requirements here, but I think that there's just a sort of a prudency here that most of the neighbors in the neighborhood are opposed to this. Even Mr. Curtis in the last meeting had mentioned that he didn't feel like it was a proper utilization of the land. And I think that's just kind of where we're coming from the neighborhood perspective. Yes, we're meeting criteria, and you know, Mr. Erickson can come in and say we're hitting all these things, and that's appropriate, and that's what the council needs to hear. But the neighbors on the other side of this are saying, we're living here, we're seeing this. We're talking about taking up 40 mature trees. And we don't think that that's going to have impact, regardless if you put a bush in. A bush does not equal a mature oak tree. And that's where we're coming from a neighborhood perspective. It's not that, I'm not trying to, you know, piecemeal certain things together. It's just that we don't feel like it's comfortable. The neighborhood doesn't feel like it's comfortable to have this move forward. It might fit the requirements, but the neighbors is the other side of this, and that's all I wanted to say.
We have members of the Trails Committee.
Yeah. I just have a couple comments. I'm Will Finch, 51 Mill Street, also a member of the Trails Committee. My first question is the date of the deed. Do you have the date for the large parcel as well as that small one that is, was it a set aside as a lot before August 1996, which is when the River Protection Act came into effect?
It was. I'm pretty sure it was 1854 when it was made into a lot. I'm not sure if I have the deed with me, but I'll check.
Yeah.
But
yeah, that was,
it's obvious that the guy who owns it has
been
paying taxes on that for 50 or 60 years.
Mm-hmm. Every year they pay their taxes. Now, you know, they just have a right to use their land, to sell their land.
No, that's fine. I just wanted to clarify that because I hadn't. But obviously the issue of whether that small lot down at the end of Arnold Ave needs to be solved, because that's part of the whole equation. I do feel that there has not been enough mitigation offered in terms, you know, I did the site visit with the permission of the owner as well as the Conservation Commission with the Trails Commission on Sunday, last Sunday. Seeing the footprint of the house, its proximity to the perennial stream there, the serious impact on the riparian area in the first 100 feet. We need to show mitigation to compensate for that impact on the inner 100 feet. And I don't see that this house has been reduced in size from the last meeting. It's certainly a lot bigger than it needs to be. That's part of the mitigation process. The other issue we were looking at was to obtain a trail easement on the property. There's two possibilities. One is going from Arcadia Avenue straight up the hill to the north of the proposed house, and then back down the backside, and across the river area, so that we could have a future trail connection that would connect this neighborhood over to Johnson Woods area, because it's a trail that goes all the way through Johnson Woods, all the way up to some more conservation area. So that's, in a sense, that easement is something we'd like to request at this point. The other mitigation efforts that have been done in similar lots elsewhere in town is where either a conservation restriction is put on the part of the parcel that's not buildable, or an outright donation to the town. I hope that's something that the owners are aware of or considering. The other thing is, I hope those are deer-proof arborvitae that you're proposing. There is a species that deer do not like, and because it's just deer candy, you can plant the normal arborvitae.
Steve, let me ask you, would the applicant consider conservation restriction on the...
I offered that in my letter.
Okay.
There's the deed, 1884. Somebody's been paying taxes on that land since 1884. In my opinion, the guy has the right to use his property. Thousands of dollars in taxes since 1884. No. I don't know. I think people have property rights.
They do. And
so.
And we have to honor those. We just can't put our neck, we just can't deny it for what has been presented to us. That's my feeling. I think a conservation restriction would be appropriate. How do other members of the commission feel on the wetland component? You know, the emergent marsh and the riverfront area.
If the applicant is offering it, then I think we should take it.
We don't have a problem with the restriction, are we?
Yeah.
I mean, there's not much we can do. It's all riverfront, and we're using up, we're not using up our total 10%. But there's not much else we can do with this property to begin with. So put any restriction on it you want.
So.
What about the road trails easement?
We'll write the conservation restriction to allow trail easements.
Is the applicant okay with that? I haven't heard that
yet. Well, the Conservation Commission will be in control of the property after the easement is signed.
Oh, I get you. Okay.
So which easement?
What?
So which easement? So which option?
We don't need to even figure that out. We'll put the whole back lot in a conservation restriction and allow trails to be created.
Correct.
Well, option two is not...
Option two is not a good idea.
No. That's not in the wetlands area.
Yeah, we don't mind the trail.
The only reason why option two is there...
On the right-hand property line, it doesn't make sense. I'm sure that wouldn't make the neighbor happy.
I think it's
obviously obtrusive.
Yeah.
Alternative.
Yeah, our goal is mainly to maintain our rights to access to the wetlands.
What kind of bridge would you propose going over the Abajona River?
Big one.
Well, first we need to determine the mean annual high water,
right.
Which I assume has been done in this case already.
I think it's a lot of. I think it's a lot of building for. I don't know, not a lot of...
Well, exactly, but it's aggressive. Just simply
yeah.
want
Yeah, it's aggressive, and you've got that whole other area across there with parking spaces. That's my feeling.
One of the other things that I'd just like to put 2 cents in here is you have option one, option two. I would like to see an option three in here, go up the boundary that's on the Woodman-Redding boundary. And that, because I think that...
It's not passable.
It's not passable?
Well, that's something we've considered.
Because the thing is, I think just that option one there, it's just, you know, we have all the rest of that, and it's not really impinging upon anyone's privacy, you know, peaceful habitation of their domicile, you know, to come up that side. And it could join with the other trail that you have that's further up off the actual four-acre site. So if you came up on that side, which is, as we're looking at here, on the lower part of that, I would be more in favor of a trail going in that area on that site, that the 4 acre site, than where it's proposed for option one.
Right. We're just to make sure we don't run out of time here, we're not talking about trails tonight that have to be proposed and a notice of intent have to come in for a trail in the future. This is just going to be a restriction saying that those things can happen, and you'd probably want to get some public input about any trail going in this area. So I think we have this under control.
Okay. Do I have a motion?
Question.
Well,
is it something new, or is it the same thing?
No, it's not the same thing.
Okay, your name, please.
Bill Allert, 22 Arnold Ave. At a prior meeting, we were discussing another project. There was a lot of concern with cutting trees down that the lack of shade/new sunlight
was dangerous to the wetlands. 40 trees is a lot. It's not being replaced on property. It's $250 a tree instead. Is that something that should be a concern here, because you're opening up a lot of area? There's going to be a lot of sun now.
There's a lot of open area. It's an emergent marsh as you go further down, so it is open, and it still functions as a very viable wetland. I don't personally have an issue with opening up the canopy. That's my personal opinion.
The other issue was over at Randall Road, and they were taking trees down right around the wetland, so it would get more direct sunlight. This is really at the top of the hill, kind of a pine grove. There's sometimes there might be a wetland at the top of the hill, but usually it's a dry area, and that's why the pines grow there. I did have two questions before you asked for a motion.
Okay.
And someone's raising their hand too.
I just had a follow up on the trees, a different question, Greg Salvatelli again. With taking down 40 trees, a lot of those trees are pine trees, and if you start taking down a lot of trees, the wind will start to come in and knock down other pine trees. What is the mitigation and review done on the trees surrounding those 40 trees that you're taking down? Because
once you start
to take down those oaks and other items that are they're protecting it from the wind, you know, what is going to happen with that wind channel?
So that came up at the last meeting, and we did ask for an arborist to go out and
evaluate
the neighbor's trees, and specifically the one where that option two is. And I don't know, did that happen?
No.
So that
I don't know how to answer the question, because on one hand they're asking us not to cut trees, and on the other hand they're telling us we've got to take down more trees because we're losing the nurse trees. There's no solution to that.
Yeah. Well, we've just had some advice from a lot of arborists that have come through the commission that one pine tree can't stand by itself. It needs to be in a cluster, and when you take down a few, you know, sometimes you need to take down two remaining or something like that. So we just want to get some eyes on it so we feel comfortable about that. How could you get around it? No, I don't know if you're cutting any trees in that area that are going to be close enough to disturb the trees on the other lot. But it did come up as a question. So who's cutting down the trees? Do you have a person that has an arborist in their company? So it probably wouldn't be a big...
I don't, but I can get somebody.
Yeah, I mean, you could combine those two things.
You can put it in the order of conditions, and we'll give you a report on it before construction starts.
I think that's how I would handle that. And then we could amend the order if we had to, or we could just make a minor plan change with that information. My other question, if you're finished... my other question was the driveway drainage. I was also wondering if it flowed straight down, flowed to the left, flowed to the right, how that was set up. I prefer to ask you, did you see that on the plan? Are you going to be able to design the driveway so all the water, when it runs off and that sheet flow, would kind of go back into the lot and not into the neighboring lot?
I can't get it to go back into the lot, okay? If you want, I can put a trench drain
at
the bottom.
Back into the lot, off the side. You know how it comes down?
I could crown the driveway,
yeah.
Or I could put a trench drain at the bottom with a small drywall.
Could you angle
that
from right to left? And here's a driveway here. It's going to flow in this direction. Everything's coming down in this direction. Is there any way we can go like this and have it spill into this area here?
That's what it's doing right now, according to his study. But
that's the answer I wanted.
Yeah.
That's where it's going.
Yeah.
Okay. The trench drain at the bottom is going to be a question for the engineering department.
Okay.
They will require one if it's needed.
Do I have a right to ask for one at that hearing?
There's no hearing. You have to go...
You have to go to the engineering department.
It's more about numbers and...
Chuck, how do you see that it's draining that way? Tell me what numbers you're looking at to tell me.
If you look at the arrows that are on the plan.
Right, I see it from the 85 times 7 by 7, 10% arrow. I see that.
Yeah.
But I look at the right, and it's 85.
He's got the arrows running through here, and that's part of the hydrology. It shows up better on the stormwater plan. If you wanted to, we could, you know, we could tilt the driveway when it's installed by a couple inches on one side. We could crown it so it goes on the side. I like to put a trench drain.
It's like it's going right where it's supposed to go.
Yeah.
Okay. Those are expensive.
Yeah. Just great. So it goes to the front.
The neighbor's asking for a trench drain. He's saying a trench drain. What do you think of that? A trench drain at the base, is that needed?
I don't see why you need it.
We'll hear a motion.
I do have a question, please. So, we talked about drainage, we talked about the trees, we talked about everything, and, you know, the wind from the building, Blueberry Hill was knocked down and so forth, a lot of winds come through there, knocked down various of trees as you walked around the property the other day, you saw some downed trees, one just recently and so forth. Knocked down 40 trees plus minus, and what guarantee as a homeowner on both sides of this development that some of these trees aren't going to go down, because you're going to be hitting the rooting system on a lot of it with you, and then you're going to have a lot of noise. There goes the animal study. I haven't seen the animal study. I know a lot of the animals that are out there. I'm not saying we're going to stop the property, but you have a 35-foot structure. And Chuck earlier in one of the meetings, if not the prior meeting, said it had to be something that was suitable to the neighborhood. I mean, if this is the last of the meetings, where do we have the lay of the stand on? And we've gone to every single one of these. We've been very, very, very patient and knowledgeable and listening to you people. Some have, some sides, some changed and so forth. I mean, I've educated myself as much as I possibly could. But I don't have water in my basement. Are you going to guarantee me I'm not going to have water in my basement? They don't have water in their basement. Are you going to guarantee them tonight that they're not going to get water in their basement if you destroy this land, this hill, this slope, and so forth? I mean, there's no real guarantee here. He's going to throw something up there and move on. It's a project.
I don't understand the logic of putting a foundation in sand is going to affect the water table when there's no water table there.
Okay, you know what? We're going to move on. Do I have a motion?
Go ahead, Dave. I don't have anything here. I'll make a motion to approve the plan with the conservation easement that we talked about with the
arborist.
Reports from the arborist on site for a possible minor modification if needed after that, reviewing that report. And
we're only motioning to close
notice of intent.
But and then I'll write the right
this motion to close
review.
The
hearing. Do we hear a second?
Second.
All those in favor? Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. We have a notice of intent for 1264 Main Street, map 45, lot 104 and 106, Mass Equity Investments, LLC. Public hearing is now open and being conducted concurrently under the authority of the Mass Wetlands Protection Act, Mass General Laws, Chapter 131, Section 40 as amended, and the Reading General Bylaws, Section 7.1. Hearing will be conducted in the following manner. Applicant will present the proposal, commission will receive reports, and the commission will address questions and comments to the applicant. Public will be given an opportunity to ask questions of the applicant, which should be directed to the chair, and please give your name and address before your comments. I'd like to introduce members of the Conservation Commission, starting on my left.
Chuck Tirone, Conservation Administrator.
Mika Scanlon, Vice Chair.
Rebecca Longley, Chair.
Harry Curtis.
Al Couillard.
David Panette.
Hi, John. Did you get a DEP file number?
No, not yet.
Okay. That's it.
Okay. Sorry, I was on the hallway. So we're up?
Yeah.
Checking on you.
Yeah. Hold Spain on. Street.
Thanks.
For the record, my name is John Tilton from Williams Surprises Engineering. And we got the second here.
Not that one?
Yeah, we'll start with that one. This is a proposed five-lot subdivision of 1260-1264 Main Street. It may look familiar to you. I was in here in the fall. We discussed the project informally. It was more to address access to the property home, the town right in the back, and Kirching Woods. So what we're proposing is a five-lot subdivision. There's two parcels here, one here, the triangle, and one bigger one. They're connected. There's two existing homes on the site. This is kind of an older rendering. One here we want to keep and raise this house and add additional four houses. So in all, there's additional three homes proposed on the parcels. It's going to be accessed through a 60-foot right-of-way with 30-foot wide with paved roadway. I show on the right-hand side here, here's the wetland system that we delayed in the fall. White there, line here represents a 25-foot buffer, then the 35-foot buffer here, and the 100-foot buffer here. So you can see most of the site work in the buffer zone is on the right-hand side here. As you look to the property straight up from Main Street, it slopes topography from left to right. Do you have the topo plan, dependent topo?
Which one are you talking
about? Julia, that's the same one. Well, we got to use this one here. So this is existing condition. Existing house here and house here. We kind of highlighted in color. The green, the wetland. This is the orange, is the 25-foot. This is yellow, but it's hard to see, 35-foot. Now, do you have the proposed conditions? This shows the trees on it, so it's kind of
the next one. Existing right there.
Or that one. Yeah, that shows the houses. Did she give you all the plans, Julie? Those are the older ones.
Julie provided
her for a whole new set of
No, you needed the set. Yeah,
she
didn't send it to me yet. No.
Okay. Well, the plans you have represent the ones I have here. The ones here are a little bit different. Can you turn the screen off?
Sure.
So we provided Julie with the full set. You know, assume she was going to distribute to you. So from left to right, I want sheets 5 of 8 proposed conditions on the site, and it's the same one you have.
It is the same.
This is
right.
The same one here you're looking at. The ones that he has, older set.
Yeah.
The planning board provided the planner with the new planner. So here are the 5 lots.
Sorry, can I ask a question?
Yeah.
Do any of us know what you have?
What you have here is what we submitted in those for 10.
So
what is on the screen there is not what we provided.
Maybe I didn't get the packages this week. Didn't show up.
I got none.
So I can't, as young as I feel, I can't read any of that. So you're going to have to bear with us a little bit.
Sure. I'll see you in the next
one.
You
know, you can read the small version.
Yeah,
I've got the big
version. I traveled with it. I've
put on
all my plans.
Do you want this one?
No, I'm okay with the plans. As long as everybody on the commission can share.
Where's the 100-foot line?
Do you guys want this one? 25, 30 is that. 100? All right, 100 foot is this.
Did you find it? So everything on the left-hand side of the cul-de-sac, south side, is outside the boundary.
That's correct.
He's at 25 to 30.
Yeah.
Yep.
You're proposing putting
this is
three houses in the buffer zone and renovating the house in the buffer zone.
That's correct. So.
And the
infiltration.
And the road is just outside the buffer zone.
Correct. So kind of having the blue here, as you plan. So there's an existing
adding
home.
Two renovating one.
Right.
Yeah. One, two.
Oh, I'm
adding
sorry, the retention
two.
Pond. You can't live in that.
This is
for
no, you
this
can't live in
that.
Yeah. You
right,
can't.
So that's for the turtles.
No.
Two people. Two houses and a renovation. This is a
make sense?
Yep.
See, I kind of outlined the blue. So everything to the right of blue is within 100 foot buffer zone. This existing house, we plan to add on to it, but keep it there. Proposed house here, retention pond, another corner of the house is within the buffer zone. So everything's over here is in the buffer zone. The left hand side, two homes, and most of the roadway, or all the roadway, is outside of the buffer. We're proposing two stormwater management areas. One's in the back, you can see a small detention pond, collects the water from the roadway. There's one in the front too, a subsurface detention area in front of the house. That is, we didn't want to put above ground because of the look of it towards Main Street, so we want a subsurface system here, which discharges to the wetlands. On the back is less, so we're not proposing any work in any of the buffer zones. You have the 25 foot, we're keeping out of that. The 35 foot, we're proposing a wall about 3 or 4 feet high for the grades there, and we'll drop down just outside the 30 foot buffer zone, no build zone. So in that area, we're not proposing walls or houses or anything. We'll only leave this undisturbed like that. I know Chuck had mentioned a few of his comments. We haven't addressed those yet from the DRT meeting. We plan to. Demarcations on the 25 foot, things in that manner we will address. And here's the color version here. We did locate trees before with the bylaw. We were, we saw on the tree policy after the fact. So we have provided tree locations on the plans. Here, but we don't show them just yet. So this rendering here, which got a little rained on last planning board meeting, is the truer version of the proposed layout. Proposed trees, both sides of the road. We have the sidewalk on the right-hand side here. It all drains the same system, detention pond in the front. I know Chuck had asked on the left-hand side to move it farther from the well, and we can do that. It performs the same manner. It still drains into the same system.
Well, I was hoping that by moving the sidewalk, the houses would move up, but I was told that that can't happen.
Yeah, it's because the setbacks. We can't move it right away. We could move the other side. I don't know if that's, but it still functions the same way.
Yeah. Well, if the houses don't move up, it doesn't really make a difference.
And what we're proposing is, in the back, a parking area here, a kiosk, and a trail system to a walking path linking to the town of Reading property back here. I know he mentioned that we'll provide some language for the easement. It's for future roadway. If the town ever wants to exercise that, it's not for us to use. But it's to provide easements, access easements to the rear. We do want to
trim a few trees back in here, because there's a big tree right in the edge here.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I would limit some of the clearing in here, what I'm fine with. I think in here, we need to cut some trees down for the grading and for the house location.
That comment was about coming to an agreement before you're taking trees down and then having something in place so the neighbors don't take trees down,
right,
you know, on that easement area in the future.
Which is this easement here.
Right.
So it leads to the link into the private property or the sort of town land. So the idea is not to clear cut this and leave, you know, some of the trees best we can, but allow us to cut some trees that the house is in here. And so that's a big summary.
Can I understand this proposal? I was talking to Chuck a bit about this. The houses that we see, these are just kind of sketches, correct?
Yeah, so
what do you plan? You need to explain what you plan to construct with this and what will be left to whomever goes in and purchases those properties.
Right. So we put boxes on here, large boxes. It's just 2,500 square feet home. So we size so a house could fit in here. Because these could be possibly sold off or built from year to year. Now, we don't know whether they want a ranch, three garage, so you don't know. So we box it to fit the house somewhere in there. We account for impervious area for the homes up to this size. We're assuming they're gonna be smaller. The driveway maybe they want to drive in the side. We don't know as a developer comes in and as he sells these, you know, what type of houses might go in there.
So you're sizing your stormwater runoff based on a certain size. What's to say that somebody comes in and wants something bigger and wants to put a pool in and put in a patio?
Right.
Now you've increased the impervious surface.
So as we said, you know, I know in the past what conditions have been set that a lot has a certain impervious calculation that when they file a building permit or a notice of intent, they gotta meet that. If they don't, they're gonna provide additional stormwater management, whether a drywall system here or meet those standards, which is very common we see, because down we don't know, this may be smaller, but that doesn't mean we can reduce the retention pond because this house may be bigger. So we make sure we can meet what's there. If they go over it, then they gotta meet stormwater management.
That you're talking about our aquifer protection district policy.
I'm talking about more or less for the drain study. So this is designed for 2, 5, 10, 25, 100-year storm.
Okay.
So can I ask a question? Are you experienced with developing cul-de-sacs like this using the low-impact development strategies? And what would you propose? Because that doesn't look low impact to me.
You're right.
You know, if you could move that road, like I could foresee a low impact scenario where that road kind of hugs the left side of the lot line, and it's, you know, and the houses are pulled away further from the resource area, which is ideally what I'd like to see.
Yeah.
And you might, depending on the, you know, the configuration, you might still be able to get a similar, you know, close to the same number of houses there.
So I wanted to, what we did, I met with Julia Planner, we came back with a roadway shorter length, 24 feet of pavement proposal, and round is shorter here, and south one side. DOT did not like it. They basically said, in engineering, police department, they want the 30-foot roadway, they want it where it is. I don't know if you have that plan ahead up there. You can see we were coming with a low impact design, because that's what kind of what Julie wanted, and we kind of were told, nope. And
is that because of safety standard? What's the?
Well, DPW
can you
said,
comment on that?
You know, cars getting by, the car parked in the street. They want the 30-foot. If they drop back from 30 feet to 24, now setting a precedence for the next subdivision coming in. So it was a no. It was a no from that. Police department agreed with them for safety issues. 24 is what we really wanted. For two reasons. It's cheaper, and it's less impervious area, less impact. And Julie was on board with us with that. There's a plan there, Chuck.
That's it?
I think so, yeah. And
so let me understand what you're asking for in this notice of intent.
Is it the grading on all?
Yeah, it's gonna go on in a second.
Is it grading for the entire, all of the properties? Or does the person who purchases like a lot come in and grade it?
So we're proposing for the infrastructure, the roadway, including house locations for the drain study. What we're saying, every property that isn't within the buffer zone has to come back to individual location plan. Because we don't know, they may change that slightly. So that's our purpose here.
So are you asking for grading, or will the grading be up to them?
The grading too. They'll have to follow the grading scheme. I mean, when they come to us and need to submit a plot plan, an individual notes, hence, they'll have to match up what we have here. And as Chuck would view it, he says, you're not matching up from the proposed plan. So they have to follow this, but they'll be filing a separate notice of intent. Because they'd be coming, like I said, with a house with a pool in the back, and we would make sure it conforms to the original design.
Can I ask you can I simplify that question just for a second? Let me just simplify that and ask, are you doing too much development, and can you do less on each lot so we can leave whatever trees are up there and look at these individually when whoever the contractor is comes in to purchase a lot, and we can look at these as individual lots, or maybe save more trees, not have a retaining wall in the back, or build that a different way.
That may be the case, that would come back. But I need to size the detention ponds and infrastructure based on this plan here. Because if I don't do that now, when they come in, they may be undersized.
Right, so you have to take down all the trees and do the grading around the retention pond, but you have to do it in lot 5 and 4?
In 5 and 4.
Do you just leave those alone?
We could right now until they come back and they develop it. We don't have to touch that right now. But if they come in here with a small home, less impervious, they still need to file a notice of intent, what we're saying.
Right, I get that.
Okay.
And do you need that retaining wall in the back? Is that?
I see what you're saying. No, I mean, they may come back and say, we don't need it. We'll show in the backyard. We're providing like a 20-foot backyard.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, like, I need a 5-foot backyard. It's just unreasonable.
So the thing that I think is giving us all fits is we don't know what you're proposing you actually do on this lot versus what's going to be left to the buyers of the individual lots. So you're proposing putting in a road, stormwater management system,
and a detention basin.
Based on our design, right.
And you laid out where the hoses theoretically would be in a likely scenario.
Right.
To help you design the become a calculation problem if you're not figuring it out.
Right.
And so you're not proposing to build any houses.
Well, they will eventually, but not.
But you're
not filing a notice of intent for lot 1,
your
2, 3, 4, 5.
Your NOI would just be the road and the stormwater management.
Right. And I guess where the houses locations are on the left-hand side, too. These here. These homes would need to own a notice of intent. But yeah, we want to count the driveway. We want.
But the houses on the left-hand side aren't even in the
right, they are part of the stormwater management system, which is in the buffer zone.
Surface.
So we want to make sure that,
right.
I mean, these, I guess they don't count, but this is designed based on these houses over here. Everything runs this way. And so we're designed, we got to come up, we just can't come up with a system here without any houses on it. So that's how we're going to narrow the
oversight. I'm just trying to understand what you're asking us to approve.
Okay, I can approve the plan if you submitted it, yes. But I'm saying we want to go one step farther is that when these three lots in the buffer zone, that they should come back to you because they may be able to change something. If they go to the building inspector and said, I got approval, but they put, a three-car garage, a pool, a patio, a basketball court, now they're going above and beyond the approvals.
Right.
So, and it affects our drainage system.
And the existing house, is that part of this?
Yeah, it's part of it. It's all considered. The entire parcel, we did a watershed map existing, and proposed.
No, I'm sorry, I asked the question wrong. So the existing house is there.
Yeah.
It's already there.
Right.
You're not proposing doing the reno on that house.
They're going to do some reno. The house is going to remain, but they want to add on to it. The driveway is actually in the front here. We're going to take it off Main Street and access to the back.
And that's part of this proposal.
Correct.
Okay. All right.
And you're not doing the work on the retaining walls that I see this side of the property.
Well, I mean, I don't know. The applicant's here. They may want it to let become more perchable because they can see where the wall is. And this is, I'm not buying unless the wall's up. But these walls are outside here. We put them outside the buffer zone, 35 foot. The 4 feet high, we're not even grading the 35 foot. We're staying out of that. There may be some work to get the wall in there. But these walls are, you're talking this high at the ground. It's to prevent people from, you know,
they,
going.
They are in our buffer zone. They're in the 100 foot, right?
100 foot, right?
Yeah.
Not the 35
not
feet.
The 30, they're outside the 35
right.
foot.
Right.
So let's go back to the, if the contractor meets the impervious amount, they can reconfigure inside there. As long as they don't go closer, would they need a new notice of intent?
I think they need a notice of intent anyways.
No matter what they do.
Right. Right.
Okay.
If you want to have control over this lot, because he doesn't meet, say he is in violation of the order.
Yeah.
He would hold up these lots too.
What happened to drawing a square and building inside the building envelope?
Which we did here. So these
and
are lots.
And they would need another notice of intent.
Well, you can do that too, but if he files a building permit and he puts a basketball court in the back,
yeah.
I mean, I have no control of that.
Right.
Well, you would. So these are big boxes. These are big boxes, and we did it on purpose. Oversized the home. Here's just a patio, a larger walkway. But when it comes to us, we'll provide the impervious calculations, and I can provide it to you, and I will be back. Each lot with the impervious maximum they can have per lot. And then when they submit a proposal, we do a lot of towns. You're going to be below that, at that, or below that impervious number. And then when they do an as-built, you can provide, did you meet those impervious calculations? And that's part of the, basically that's how it typically works.
Did you guys, I heard from Greg, one possible outcome for the tree policy. What's your plan for our replacement tree policy?
Yeah, we looked at replacing all the trees, but you know, there's a lot of stuff taken up in the homes. And, I mean, it's kind of impractical to get all those in there. I don't know, do you work with the applicant? I mean, a little bit. We put some trees here. There are street trees, additional street trees. We can add trees there. I count about, it's in the plan, 27 trees in the buffer zone will be taken down. You know.
Are you including cutting the trees on this whole lot or just for the utilities in the road?
So we look at every tree, 6-inch diameter, every tree in the entire site. Get a number, but we also count the ones in the buffer zone that we would be cutting down. We count 27, I think it's in here.
Mm-hmm.
Seat there. So we want to know, provide you with that number. I know it's a policy you have here, one-to-one, I don't know.
How many can you, do you know how many you can place? What I heard was you're not doing a landscaping plan because of the way you're marketing the lots.
Right.
You don't know what's going to go there, so that number's just hanging out. That's why I asked you in the beginning, is there any way you can leave the lots alone and let the notice of intent, whoever gets the lot, do the notice of intent and deal with the tree policy?
Maybe, but the applicant may sell. I mean, I know there's some thought of selling lots initially or developing all together. So they may want to go there and cut what they can
mm-hmm.
and build those walls and then bring us present to the site and say, this is your property. So
yeah.
I think that's what they want to do.
The thing that I think Chuck's getting at that we want to avoid is bulldoze the entire right side of the road.
Right.
And the economy takes a dive like 2008 and you've got a desert for the next 10 years. That's what we don't want.
Right.
Because we've seen that happen.
Yeah, I mean, that's the way the market goes. I mean, typically you have ask for a bond. Bond can cover that. I wouldn't be surprised if the planning board's going to require a bond for that. We can do it in stages. You know, the infrastructure, the roadway's going to be in first before the foundation's in. I know they're going to do some clearing here.
What's the purpose of the retaining wall?
So in the back.
Just ensure you have a level lot to build on?
Yeah, so. I'm just drawing this. So we have the street, goes like this, and the lots go like this, and they drop off to the wetland system here. So if we put the wall, here's your buffer zone, we want to put a wall like that and kind of level it off with the house here. So it's like a 4 foot wall. Instead of grading into your buffer zone like that, your 35 foot, we're going to look at 4 foot, 3 foot high wall, stone wall, but also marks we're kind of encourage people not to go beyond that mark. We probably could just, we would need a wall, it's like graded down, but that would be in the 35-foot buffer. So we're trying to keep out of the 25, which we did, and out of the 35 totally. And a 4-foot wall, and you know, Chuck mentioned a little fence and markers there to, you know, discourage people from going beyond that.
The problem we always have with that is less about people going in there, more about people putting on the leaves and grass.
Right.
Yeah, that's what it was about.
Yeah.
No, I just didn't know enough about why the wall was supposed to be there and where it went. I know it kind of ties into the detention pond and dies off in that area.
Right.
But with a fence on top of it, it seems to define the lot. And with our signs on that, it makes a lot more sense.
Yeah.
Right.
The grades here are tight, so you know we want to sort of put the wall there.
Right, and that is real tight. And that first lot there, I wanted to try to understand why you need that big turnaround area, because it really takes up the lawn.
Yeah.
Don't have much lawn, and
so what we did here, we have this program for auto turn. We can see if a vehicle can get in and out of there. So we just do a simple turn. We needed that space back just so the car could back out. Otherwise, it's pretty tight there. I see at the bottom here, you brought up a good point, is that if water runs down the driveway, we should infiltrate it at the bottom of the driveway. It's not a lot, but we'll propose some type of infiltration at the bottom of that driveway. I do need to turn out there to get a car, so it's not making a bunch of turns to get out. So our probe says it needs that much room to get out, but we can put that gravel with some kind of.
And the only other concern is, can you think of something? I'm not saying the snow can't go in that area, but is there,
maybe.
Well, I'm not saying it can't go in that area. I mean, it's kind of hard to drag snow out of that long a driveway, but
yeah.
I guess it could go off to the side, but that's not really their land either.
Yeah, probably puts the snow. This, you know, I don't know what you do there.
For that particular house, just to piggyback on what you're saying, can the garage be moved so it's on the street side of the house?
We over here?
The side street, the cul-de-sac street.
The grades were too high. There's actually like a 5-foot difference. So if we came in here, we'd be at the
What I mean
this
is.
This side here?
No. Instead.
Sorry.
You want me to show you?
Sure.
Okay. Instead of driving all the way past the house
mm-hmm.
to go into the back, why can't the garage be moved here?
Okay, that's a good question. What it was is, it's very steep here, so we need to get down to the basement level. Now, for here, a slope would be, we looked at doing that actually. We have to drop it down about 5-6 feet and about 20 feet, so we have like a 25-foot slope, very steep. So we had it kind of the size and less than the slope, so we're flat down here. Kind of why we did that. We looked at what you were saying. We wanted to come in here or like that, but the pitch would be too great, and we had to run it a longer length that way.
So, because it looks like in that area at least, where that garage, where the driveway kind of ends, let's see, the elevation of that is 208, and the native grade. 205. So you're already adding 3 feet of fill,
right.
At least there, and then adding additional fill to build up to the road.
Right.
Why is? I guess I'm wondering why so much fill to build up the road.
Right. It says build the roadway up. You call it the driveway, the roadway.
Roadway. You know what I mean?
Yeah. You're talking strictly this area here?
For road A.
Road A.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, well.
You know what I mean? Because it looks like.
Yeah, it does. The problem
like
does
at least 3 feet is being added right across everywhere. So, of course, if more is added,
right,
it's going to be a steeper driveway.
And so, the topography runs like this. So, we had to run the road. We kind of trying to do a balance of the site. So we're in the road like this, and so this will be a cut on this side, and you have to fill on this side. So if you lower it more here, then you have a larger cut coming out. So you try to balance the site, and also these homes would be sitting too high in the air, So you kind of, it's a balance between where the houses sit, cut and fill the roadway. So this is why this site's higher, but we're trying to reduce the minimum. The more cut we have left, the more trees come down on the left-hand side too. So it's kind of why we balance it. It's a good question, but we kind of double up and down, try to find a good working grade through there.
So the infiltration that was designed, I don't see anything in here about what rainfall data was used to design those infiltration.
Yeah, so we did, it was for the, so we're gonna put the 2, 5, 10, 25, and we submitted the drainage study to the engineering department, and
so,
they,
okay.
Yeah, they approved it already.
Did you use the Cornell?
Climatic
data?
I actually didn't do it.
You want to look?
Yes,
it's nice thick tone. It's good. If you're not familiar with the Cornell climatic, are you familiar with that data set?
Yeah, I am. We use the Hydro AutoCAD.
Yeah, I know, but you still have to input a storm, a design storm.
Yeah, I'll have to check with that. Our design engineer will know that.
Right, so 100-year rainfall, they have 6.5 inches. I think that's kind of, that's a little low for 100-year rainfall for Reading.
I'll double check that.
Yeah, I think the Cornell data puts it at close to 8 inches for the 100-year, 24-hour storm.
Oh, Jack, I know he spoke with Ryan about that, engineering.
I don't know if engineering's concerned with climate change.
I don't know. I can talk about the
doesn't sound like it lately, but I'm hoping to have a couple back room conversations with them to.
All right. I'll
push that
there.
Interest in that looks low.
So we'll be getting, I guess we didn't see the trees, the survey of the trees.
Correct. I think there might be in the plans that we submitted, but we want to discuss to you how, you know, I know it's a fairly new policy. I think it was in the fall.
This year, yeah.
And I don't know.
2016.
Yeah. So is you require us to meet one-to-one? Is that what the, or is there some?
You can do one-to-one, replacement, or you can do some shrubs, two shrubs to one, or you can make a donation.
Right, okay.
To the tree.
Okay, I didn't know if that policy was something you could work with, or you.
It's on our website.
All right, so that's
our policy.
Okay.
Yeah.
And also, I did look at the DEP sheets for wetland delineation. They're taken at A7. Just tell your biologist that his hydrology sheet for the wetland is filled out incorrectly for the little box down the bottom that said no for hydrology present, and it was. You could see that there were models and it was very hydric soil, so you need to have yes,
okay.
yes.
So can we go back to the tree policy for a second? So John, just try to help you out just a minute here.
Yeah.
That a lot of the work on this project was front-end loaded, and as part of mitigation, we're getting a three-car parking lot, a trail easement, and a kiosk, all provided by the applicant. And I think that when we put the policy together, we knew that there were sometimes going to be huge numbers out there. It's not like any of these lots are not going to get trees and shrubs on them. We could make a requirement that the ones that they do plant have to be native, but since no one knows what's going to happen, it can't go against the 27 that have been cut. So that 27 is $6,500, $6,750. And I would say that you need to think about that number, know that trees are going on the site, and then also realize what the big give back we're getting here with that trail and and that parking, and then now you guys can, take it from there.
So the 27 trees, that's one of the reasons I think we're all encouraging them not to cut them all down.
No, I understand what Chuck's saying. My client brought to my attention too is what Chuck's saying. We're offering easement to the back process and a trailway at their cost.
Yeah.
And the thing is, so if we provide you that, maybe there's some leniency on the tree policy, because this is be some grading involved in there.
I'm not saying we're working on this.
Right. That's kind of what's getting at. So.
So are we including the trees you're required to plant in the right of way, Chuck?
They're outside the buffer zone, but try to keep everything in the buffer zone that we're talking about.
Right.
And the trail easement's not in the buffer zone either, but it is, that's Kirchian Woods back there, and that's going to be a new connection to Kirchian Woods and open up a whole new area access to a vernal pool. So it's a nice little feather in our cap.
Well, that would take a big curse out of it. I don't know how you guys feel about it. We'd allow the right of way tree.
Why don't we review a proposal? Then maybe they come up with something.
Yeah, we still need a site visit, and I don't know if Chuck had talked to you about staking out those houses.
Yeah, we can do that. Do you want the ones in the buffer zone or all of these?
We'd like to know the road and the three houses and the detention pond.
Okay.
I still have a question. I'm still a little confused. Is this application for the road, is it going to be one notice of intent you're looking for, or a notice of intent?
Right now, one notice of intent
infrastructure, and then you're going to come back and ask for a notice of intent for each particular lot.
That's in the buffer zone.
Right.
That's in the buffer zone. Right. Okay. So one notice of intent, roadway.
Right.
So two lots in the future would not have to come back.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
But three what?
Right.
And that's something DEP has recommended to us to do. They don't like to have that one big, because this person could be bound to the DEP's notice and the order conditions. And if he's not compliant, he can't get a sign off on the order conditions, and his house is tied into it. That's why I like to do individual ones.
The house on the south side is going to be raised.
This one here?
Are you
guys going to
raise that? Or are you
going to
sell it and someone else
will
buy it and raise it?
That's a question. Probably going to raise it.
Yeah.
It's in tough shape, and I don't, you know.
So raise it and leave it as a vacant lot?
Yeah, as a sellable lot. Clean it, take the foundation out of there. It's got to go through a demo permit through the town.
This is where I really just don't understand what's, and I apologize in advance because I just didn't get it.
No, that's okay.
But it's really not entirely clear to me, like, where your project starts and ends, and what is left for other property owners after you've subdivided the property. So that's got me scratching my head. The two other questions, the house on the right that is going to have a garage added.
Yeah.
Is just adding a garage?
We want to bump out the house a little bit right here
for the
garage. And we moved all the pervious in the front, so this will all be grass.
Right.
Move the driveway here. So we have a little addition up the side for a garage area right about here, and just extend it a little farther than what's there now.
So it's just a garage, or is it a garage in the basement or something?
Garage in the basement with the living, because it drops down.
So you're extending the whole house.
Right.
Chuck, you mentioned vernal pool, which was one of the questions that just came in. Is there a vernal pool nearby?
I think it was 230 feet away, off to the north, and then there's one to the northwest of the property. So out off the property, 200 feet away, both of them. There's one even further. So there's three vernal pools, or two certified vernal pools, and one potential off that property.
And one last question. When we do Randall Road, we put in tree boxes with phosphorus removal. Is there any thought of doing that here?
No, that applicant volunteered to bring his standards up to the new stormwater policy, which will be effective this July, and we didn't get the same, I don't even know if it was asked. So they don't have to remove phosphorus. So we had an applicant that met the standards of the new MS4 permit.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and so they're used to that, and they came up with these tree boxes for storm drains, which got 80% removal and took off the phosphorus, and it was something that the town said they would use. But it's not.
So if the permit is issued before June, it's
accepted. Application is applied for before
applied
July.
For
yeah.
All right. Does that be another way to mitigate the loss of trees?
Yeah, well, you can see that there are trees going on the site.
Yeah.
I mean, I wouldn't be so accommodating if, you know, the trail is a big deal. And it's pretty much the benchmark now for what we're doing
yeah.
any other spot.
No, it looks,
so they've done, you know,
stuff.
Everything we've asked for. But we do have that tree policy, and I think when we were putting together, we knew that this would happen. So if a more reasonable number comes out, then I mean, it almost seems justified.
Yeah.
I move we continue the hearing.
Are there any questions from the community?
My name is Steven Scullin. I live at 1252.
That's right.
Abutting the left side.
Yep.
Do we anticipate any blasting being done?
I'd say probably a chance. I know there's a lot of ledge up in here in this area, so I would suspect they're blasting on the site.
See, my house sits on the ledge.
Right.
And I have a water problem now, and in my experience, when you start blasting ledge, you have no control over what water is going to change flow and which way it's going to go and who it's going to affect once you disturb the ledge. You're not disturbing ledge here. These cracks and fissures can go anywhere. And I just wondered if that was taken into consideration, how that's going to affect me personally and the other abutters that have had water problems all these years. And there's water problems in the existing house that you're going to raise.
No, there isn't. We've never had water in the basement.
In the brown house?
In the brown house.
Yeah, that's what I meant.
The one
I'm sorry.
Raise. Okay, but not the greenhouse.
Right, but it's the brown house. And so I'm concerned about that. And I wondered how close the blasting is going to be to my property line and how close a structure can be built to my property line.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, if I'm going to have 20 feet from my property line to somebody's back porch, I want to know that now. Right now, I go out in the morning, and for 35 years, I'm sorry, I lived in that house, and I come out, and it's just beautiful in the spring and all summer. And now, I don't know how high these houses are going to be and what how it's going to be thinned out, but the way it is now, there's a lot of privacy, and I have yet to see or hear how that's going to be addressed as to what they're showing colors. That's all pretty, that's all green, but what's going on along my property line? Is that in fact going to be stay the way it is, or is my property line on the south side going to be disturbed and thinned out? And that's what I'm concerned about. And again, the wildlife that we see in our backyards, how much thought is being put into the wildlife? There's deer, there's fox, there's all kind of wildlife that come right into our yard,
mm-hmm.
and have been all these years. And I'm wondering how much consideration has been put into that. Do you push it back into the woods? Those are things I'm concerned about right now.
You're asking to maintain some privacy screening between the two houses.
Yeah, I mean, after 35 years of being a homeowner there,
mm-hmm.
and not cutting down trees myself to, you know, to do whatever, I haven't even got a tree down.
Right, and I did, you made me look at your property again, I would say that you guys, when you developed this site, you just, you know, this one down here, you just love huge driveways.
Yeah.
And that driveway is wider as it comes off the garage than the one on lot 5, and it still has that turnaround area.
This one here, yeah.
Yeah. I mean, maybe you could look at that driveway and see if
there's any reduction. Yeah, we could look at reducing the driveway here. I did talk to Julie in email that, and it's just out there. I mean, the planning board, we're going to try to maybe take some of the landscape easement, no cut zone in there,
mm-hmm.
and to restrict tree cutting and provide you, best we can, some type of screens over there. I mean, yeah, typically they would just cut all the trees down here and put the house in there, but because of your concerns and where you're located, something we're going to work with the planning board and all these kind of conservation questions. As far as the ledge and water issues, so we did some tessels up there, groundwater elevations, and everything from here goes down. So if there's any groundwater, it runs in this manner. So if it went the other way, I'd be concerned about him. But everything is draining this way. Runoff, topography, and groundwater, the grades indicate this way, away from his property.
Do you know the bedrock topography?
We did some tessels. We hit ledge pretty high up here, and some over here, and nothing down here. And we hit some water, but everything, the grades, elevation we got, it goes from left to right, away from this property. And we're grading it, so you can see on the grading scheme that we're maintaining like a slight swale, bring the water here. Nothing's pushing back this way in our proposal. Same thing here. It's brought this way, and there'll be some grass lawns here, but we're not dumping the water back to his property. That's what we showed in our plans.
Right, but that only answers one of his questions. The other one is the cracks and fissures, and I don't know if you want to take this over and make it, because you are a geologist. But do you have a hydrogeologist on your staff that could, because with the blasting, you know, it's likely, or it may be likely that, you know, exactly what I was hearing.
It could be. It's not
something else can,
right.
Things can change.
Right.
And we've heard that in other communities too.
Right.
So.
Yeah, if the planning board or the town requires it, and we do, it's not something we do. You know,
I mean, do you have to blash? Can you just chip away at it?
They might chip away. It's cheaper. If it breaks away easily, yeah, we'll chip away at it. We're doing this project behind our. We're just chipping away at it. But.
I mean, it would be nice to know, like, well, maybe for that lot, you have to chip away and everything else is far enough away, so it wouldn't matter.
I mean, I guess it's something we can look into, but I don't know what the rock base is like.
The stormwater management system,
mm-hmm.
who's going to maintain that?
So. The town would be set the roadway, so down the road. So the town would maintain the mains of the detention pond here and in the front.
That's not what I read in the notice of intent. It sounds like the applicant was.
Well, initially too, but I think if the town, I guess it depends on the planning board, whether they want homeownership to maintain it. It's maybe something they want.
I think what she needs is the town's not going to accept that road for a couple of years.
Oh,
right. So in the meantime,
we'll have a bond established.
Right.
And in the meantime, the applicant will be responsible for.
But the stormwater structure won't be accepted by the town because they can't provide access around it.
Right now.
So right now. So they'll never accept that. So the homeowners will always have to take care of this as it's proposed because of that access issue.
So you need a operation and maintenance plan and a homeowners association.
And a road.
I don't need the road.
Yeah. Well, or a road.
There'll be a sweat plan provided, yeah. Once we know, you know, what we're gonna do here.
Is that gonna, it looks wet there. Is it wet? A wet detention pond?
This one, yeah. This one here is. We do need to tweak the numbers, and you have made a good point about the two water. We're just at 1/10 below, so we'll have to raise it 1/10.
How much water do you expect in there? Is it going to be, it's going to be wet? What are we talking about, a foot?
I think like 5 inches, 6 inches, I think.
And it's going to maintain at that, pretty much?
I'll double check that. I thought so.
That's my big question regarding the Cornell data.
Mm-hmm.
You know, a lot of the old precipitation numbers that people use to plug into these models to model this stormwater drainage, they grab numbers that are from the 1960s or earlier.
Mm-hmm.
And we've had more extreme events since the 1960s. than before 1960s.
I'll ask him
so,
about that.
You know, the Cornell data takes, is NOAA verified, station averaged. It's very solid data if the government holds together now and when you check it next. But there's valid data out there that can be used, and I just have to express, you know, it's my opinion, but I'm a little frustrated that engineering seems to agree that a 100-year storm is sometimes a 7-year storm, sometimes a 6-inch storm. You know, they never come close to the Cornell data, which is an 8-inch storm, 100-year, 24-hour. You know, so it makes for, you know, those are critical numbers. They're little numbers, and that's a small difference. But that's critical to the true management of the water going forward.
Okay. I'll speak to him about that, and I'm not sure.
And I've asked him before, but I'll call him tomorrow.
Okay.
What are you talking about?
Engineer. I'll call engineering tomorrow.
They're not in.
If engineer is watching, call me.
They're not in. Public service announcement, town hall is closed tomorrow.
Oh, because of the storm.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, because if the runoff isn't if the drainage isn't calculated to contain the type of storms we actually observe, that's not going to function.
Right. I know he did.
What's the point?
Yeah, I know he did speak to Ryan a couple of times. So, but I'll check with him. I don't know. I'm sure, he didn't. I know.
Anyway,
any other questions?
So we usually ask a couple of things. We ask for a show. So you're just doing a box, but I was just going to ask you to show the decks and the patios on the plan, but I guess that's not needed. And then we need that easement language. That's something I'd like to review while the order of conditions is open. So we wouldn't want to close until we see that. We can understand that easement language.
Do I get your motion to continue the notice of intent?
I
need
them.
Okay. All in favor? Okay. Our next meeting is February
22nd. Okay. Would it be separate sidewalk between the obviously?
Yeah. We typically, you do it in two phases. We have Sunday morning and then usually Monday afternoon.
Okay. Either one's fine or both are fine with me. Because I can get a price staked out.
Yeah.
Snow by the early part of next week.
Are the wetland flags already here?
They should still be out there. We did it in the fall.
Okay.
So you want to schedule time now? Is it weird?
I'm going to try. Who's going to go out on Sunday? I assume Harry and Al.
I have extra snowshoes tomorrow. Yeah, fun.
It's not this Sunday.
It's not this Sunday. It'll be next Monday. Mm-hmm. I'll go Monday.
Okay. What do you prefer, morning?
Late morning is usually better for me, like 11.
Yeah. Let's see if we can miss that out.
Monday at 11.
That's good for me.
Oh, okay.
And
Mike,
Dave, do you know where you're at with Sunday or Monday?
I could probably do Monday.
It's Monday at 11?
Yeah.
Well, we're going to have a full boat here.
How close are you to?
We
only have one mover going on Sunday.
Yep.
You do Monday and Sunday?
You know, if I'm the only one on Sunday, I'll just go by myself if it's okay with you.
I don't mind if you need help, but
he needs a lot of help.
But with all this brain power there on Monday, I can't compete anyway, so I'll just go Sunday.
You know what I can do? We'll stick it out in the stakes with numbers on it in the description, and I'll give Chuck a copy of that plan, and you can just.
Actually, just so everyone knows, I just was looking that up. That's President's Day, so that's a long weekend. That Monday, 20th.
It's kids' school vacation anyway. I'll
yeah.
Be
I won't be there for the meeting.
Well, it's been a holiday.
Actually, I need a Monday.
It's a long vacation. Are you gonna be here? So you won't be there?
I don't think that's.
President's Day, the 20th.
I think town hall's open. I'm not really up on what days are not open, but. Because that's incorporated into school vacation, right? So the Monday of school vacation is not a work day at town hall.
The town hall should be closed that day.
So I'll likely be closed at your parents' house on that weekend than here in Reading. So, but you guys could go.
I have a question, please.
Your name, please?
Catherine Chumbagorio. I live directly behind Steve on Rocky Road, but I bought his yard. And all our houses are built on ledge. And I'm wondering how much of an impact, how much blasting is gonna go, because I don't want my walls to crack.
No, I really don't know. We just don't know right now.
So if he does, so there's two ways of handling ledge. One is with a giant backhoe with a giant hammer on it, and they can bang it and break it up, and that's best case probably for you. If they have to drill and blast ledge, they'll have to survey your property. Insurance company will come out, they'll make an appointment with you, they'll survey your basement and your foundation before the blasting, and then they'll survey your basement. And after the blasting, if there's something gone wrong, you'll be insured, you'll be covered, and they'll repair it.
Mm-hmm. And her property is directly behind the top left house. On Rocky Road, just
this one here?
Yeah. No, Angela's is.
Yours, no, but
corner.
Yours the corner one, and she's on ledge too.
Okay.
Well, we're all on ledge. The whole
right.
street's
so
ledge.
Yeah. I'm not surprised. There's a lot of ledge on that side.
I'm just concerned about the water table. The water table is high as it is already, and if you're going to blast all that out, you're going to grade for the road and for the two left houses, that's going to change the flow of everything. You can't look at the flow of the water now and say that that's the way it's going to be after all that your work is done, right?
You don't know, but we're much lower on that side than your side. It does drop down, so in what we show from our test holes up there, it does drop it away from your property. I'd be more concerned if it's the opposite way.
Yeah.
Right now.
No, he's saying when he's done.
They're leaving it. It's all still heading to the wet. It all has to still head to the wet house.
Yeah.
Well, further in the back, it's not as much of a drop as you're saying, I don't believe, in back of Kathy's, which is the last house on the right on Rocky Road. There's not that much of a change.
It's flatter towards the back, but there is, you know.
It's not as low as it is in the front, that's for sure.
Right. It's flat, a little flatter in here, but we're still pretty high in here, so. But you know, you gave a good description, example of what's required for blasting. It's quite extensive. We don't do it, but there'd be the fire department has to be there during blasting at all times. The survey's done, so you know it's not a.
Well, we've been through it when they built Rocky Road.
I'm sure you have.
Yeah.
Sorry. So if I can just comment for a second about has anybody described to you one of the reasons why you might have a water problem near ledge? Do you understand that underneath your house? I'm not getting a yes, so I'm just gonna.
Well, I don't understand what you're asking.
Well, you say you have trouble with your basement.
My pump is probably running right now.
And you also have ledge very close to your basement.
And then throughout my front yard, ledge is cropping from the surface.
So just to. Maybe I can shed some light on what's happened. It's just a guess, because
mm-hmm.
I don't know the details, but just by way of, if I can use the board for a quick sec.
Sure.
Just take a minute. Chuck, you mind turning the projector on for a second? So sort of in like cake cross section, do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So if your house is here and here's your basement,
I inherited it.
Okay, and here's the ground level here.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And your house goes up like that.
Mm-hmm.
If you're gonna like cut through, the water table goes, the rain goes through the soil, right? And it goes through all the sand until it hits the water table, okay? So the water table just exists within the soil and within the sands that are underneath. But if you have, and that, and the groundwater will flow however it's sloped. So it tends to flow from an area where groundwater is high to an area where groundwater is low. So, but if you have a situation where the water table is up here, and this is just the symbol, I'm sorry, this is just the symbol for where the top of the water table is, and you happen to have a lot of sand, a lot of sand, a lot of sand, but just because of the way the earth is, you have a huge rock, bedrock, coming up that's underneath all the sand, well, the water table is going to find the lowest area it wants to go to, right? You know, a river, water goes to the lowest area. Watch a street, you'll see which way the water wants to go. So the water's going to go from the area of highest potential to lowest potential. Here, it'll probably go this way, because you also, it's also determined by, it's not going to flow through the bedrock. The bedrock's going to act kind of like pavement, generally.
Right.
Okay, because it's essentially a solid surface compared to the soil. So when you get this water table, it also comes up against your foundation because it's kind of close to it maybe. So you get this, and you might get a little bit of groundwater flowing. I'm just guessing. You might get some of this. But then you have all the force of the water against your foundation right there, right? So because bedrock is higher, close to your the bottom of your foundation, you can get, especially because the bedrock acts like a solid surface, if there's a lot of buildup of groundwater on top of this bedrock, you can get it coming through. Does that make sense?
It does, except ledge isn't really, in my opinion, doesn't equate to bedrock.
Ledge in my world is, and bedrock is one and the same.
Okay, the ledge that I have is actually almost in layers, where I've had years when I first moved in, I had a place in my front yard dug out to make it level so I have a third parking spot. And when I was there when they were doing it, and they were breaking up the ledge, and it was almost like chunks of shale. And it was just, and he told me that it's easy to, because I thought it was going to be expensive, he says, no, it's easier. As he was hitting it, it would come off like a piece of patio stuff or something. And that's how he dug it out in the front of my house. I've never had to deal with it in the back, but it was almost like shale where it would break up. And, but I do have outcrops.
Yeah, I'm not saying that the ledge, the bedrock, is necessarily completely solid like this desk. It can be shale. It can have a lot of cracks in it.
Yeah.
But generally speaking, it compared to sand, it's going to be more resistant to moving water away from your house. Do you know what I mean? Like compared to sands. It could move water through the rock.
It doesn't do it now.
But it doesn't do it quickly.
Yeah.
So, anyway. Sorry. Thank you.
All right, thank you.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right,
John,
we'll
see
you. Okay.
I
have
a little
education.
Just
learning something.
Well,
I don't
know.
You've been there for so long.
Asking for them to investigate ledge and water with a hydrogeologist.
I just wanted to say hi. I'm the owner.
Oh, you are?
Outside the 100-foot zone.
Yeah. And what are you going to do about the Cornell data? Are you asking them to use it? What that is? They're using TR-20 and TR-55. They're using TR-20 and TR-55. That's not it. So they're just
using TR-20 and TR-55. You still have to input the data.
We drove home from Long Meadow, we get in at 11:30 at night, we pulled the trailer, so we drive into the motorcycle, and went to bed.
No, you have to do them separately.
And we got up the next morning, and we
That's a good idea, now. I've been very impressed with you.
I know you don't want paper copies, but
it lasted for a couple hours.
Do you want? That's the only minutes I have a comment on. Are we keeping Amy on? I know, but why keep Amy?
She's still a member.
She's still a member. All right, great. I didn't know.
But he didn't. And they tried to stabilize and they couldn't.
Was the first one?
I move we approve.
Hold on a second.
Do
you want to do it?
Three main arteries were 99% blocked and he was pumping at 30%. That's it. They put him on a respirator, on a hot pump, and he lasted so.
I think if we count them.
And I'm sorry, I didn't know which house you were talking about.
No, it's okay. I just called the brought off.
Can you guys?
Yeah, I know. Yeah, that's all I do too.
Oh, yeah.
Excuse me, can you just
want this open or closed?
Oh no, open, yeah. Oh, I thought that was like I thought it was pretty sheepish to do that.
Did you get any comments from Mike?
Mike is under the weather tonight. He said he didn't have any comments because he had a head cold. So we have January 11th, January 25th, November 9th, and December 14th. And I received comments from some people which were incorporated in, and then Becky called me up about some, we went over these, and I incorporated her.
ICC meeting, annual conference.
Is that on the 29th? Or is that just something? No, that's the meeting, yeah.
First Saturday, right, in March?
Yeah.
It's a thing up in Ipswich that I saw that I wanted to go to.
I plan to go.
Ipswich Town Hall.
You going?
I'm planning on going, although I was looking at, although I don't think I'm signed up for workshops, am I?
No, because you said, did I get signed up for the workshop? And I said, send me what you wanted, and I never heard from you.
Because I looked at the, okay.
It just came out.
You, there's still plenty of time.
Okay, so I'll look at the workshops.
You could even sign up online.
Right.
And they'll send me an invoice.
I will go.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'll go. I looked at the workshops and I'll be honest, I did your.
What are the feature of this year?
As a speaker?
No. Usually they have to be in the, you know, the forestry or.
I don't remember being.
There's a forest steward one.
There's a what?
Forest steward, forestry stewardship.
Mm-hmm.
That's what they had to do. It was marginal. He did it anyways. And there was a